This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Ride, Saturday.
You know, whenever I can sort of put my finger on a theme for our show, I like to do so. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I think our theme today is going to be optimism about the future of the American horse industry. And you will understand why I say that when you get to know my guest today. First up is Moses Woodson, who is a trainer and clinician specializing in gaited horses from Liberty, Tennessee. I happened to meet him at the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo in Denver. Never met him before, hadn't actually heard of him before, but I feel like I've known him most of my life now. He's a big bear of a man with a wonderful deep voice and kind of a southern accent. But it's not the sound of his voice, it's what he says that really grabbed me. As I said, he specializes in gaited horses, but he has a very different approach. He teaches them to have self-carriage and balance and not to push on the bit or to hang on the bit. He teaches them to carry themselves off of the bit and be responsible, as I said, for their own carriage. A little bit of a different approach, very compatible with natural horsemanship, not so similar to what the prevailing method of training gaited horses, especially in Tennessee, is. Next up on our show is Dana Hokana. I have been familiar with her name for many years. Our paths just had never crossed. She lives in California. I live in Arizona. We had to go all the way to Massachusetts to actually meet. But meet we did, and we had a wonderful conversation, and I found this lady to be absolutely delightful. Again, the content of what she is saying just totally blew me away. She specializes in Western pleasure performance and does very, very well in the show ring. And in the past, I've been fairly critical of Western pleasure, some of the training techniques, the gaits that they are, or non-gaits, even if you want to look at it that way, that are promoted there in the show ring. She is very critical of that herself and believes that Western pleasure can be much, much better than it is, and she's doing everything in her power. And things are changing. They are getting better thanks to people like Dana Hokana. And I think you will be as taken by her as I was. Finally, today you're going to meet a couple young people that give us tremendous hope for the future. Jessica Lane, who's all of 13 years old, and Katie Tennyson, 17, of the Easy Riders Drill Team from Missouri. Caught up with them at Equifest of Kansas. I want to tell you just a little bit about something kind of exciting in my little world. Our website, thehorseshow.com, you know, we first put that up back in 1998. Gosh, that seems so long ago. I mean, we knew this was such foreign territory for a lot of people, and including us. Fortunately, we were able to grab the name thehorseshow.com, and that has served us so well over the years. That website has gone through a number of different incarnations as we've tried to make it more responsive to what you need in terms of education and access and contact and so forth. And the newest one is up right now, and we invite you to take a look at it. It revolves entirely around our radio and television content, which is now hosted by YouTube, so it's accessible on any device. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products, like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you. Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with a lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo, Denver, Colorado. And this is the Horse Show Live. I'm your host, Rick Lamb. My guest for this segment of our show is Moses Woodson. Moses, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you for having me, Rick.
You're officially the first Moses I've ever had on the radio.
I'm the first Moses a lot of people meet.
Now, is that a family name, or is that just something your parents thought up on their own?
It's a really long story. My dad's name is Moses, but it's kind of a long story.
So are you Moses Jr.?
No, I'm Moses Aaron.
Okay. That's kind of how it is with me. My dad was a junior. He's Richard Lamb Jr., and I'm Richard Allen Lamb, so I've got a different middle name. But you are a gaited horse trainer, and I want to talk to you today a little bit about that. You come from a part of the country where there are a lot of gaited horses, Tennessee.
Yes, sir.
And it's also, I'm going to pick my words very carefully, it's the prevailing mentality of training gaited horses in that part of the country is a little different from the way you approach it.
Yes, sir. It's a little bit of a controversy, and I'm kind of an outcast where I come from because traditionally people have been doing it the other way, to say it in a nice manner, for so long, and it's hard to get them out of that traditional way of doing it. And the way that we approach it, as far as gaited horses is concerned, is a matter of balance. Horses are a three-dimensional animal, mentally, physically, and emotionally. And, you know, the old stigmatism, these gaited horses just love to go, 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 go. And people get on them and they have an experience with a horse that's been taught to go and doesn't have a whole lot of control, doesn't have a whole lot of softness, doesn't have a whole lot of bend. And they think that that's the way gaited horses should be. And we're trying to change that. It's a hard road to hoe, as old saying goes. But we do it through balance. The thing about gaited horses is gaited horses are not like quarter horses. They're not just another horse. They have a natural tendency to go. They've been bred, most of the breeds, to perform and to put up with a lot of pressure. So you don't have to work at getting them to move their feet a whole lot of times. So you take that animal that moves easily and you take traditional methods where you have to work at a horse to get him to move his feet, and it outbalances the horse. He's got too much go and not enough woe.
So when you talk about balance, you're talking about balancing in a number of senses, not just balancing his body in kind of a physical sense with his weight and so forth.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
You've got to have balance in all three areas, mentally, emotionally, and physically.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get that horse balanced physically, he's able to gait better because he's using his body more efficiently. And the way you get that horse balanced physically is by positioning and conditioning. You put him into positions that condition his body to carry himself more efficiently. Any horse that carries herself more efficiently is going to perform better.
Now, when we say gaited horses, we are talking about any breed of horse that does an intermediate gait either instead of or in addition to the trot that is a four-beat gait. Is that a fair way to describe
yes,
that?
Yes, sir.
And the reason that this class of horses is so popular right now is because it's a very smooth gait, that intermediate gait, as opposed to a trot. A lot of trotting horses are kind of uncomfortable to ride.
Yes, sir.
At that speed, anyway.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. But this does encompass a whole bunch of different breeds. Where you come from, Tennessee walking horses are huge. There's also the Missouri Fox trotting horse, the Paso horses, Paso Fino, Peruvian Paso. We have an Icelandic horse that's also a gaited breed, the Rocky Mountain horses, Kentucky Mountain Pleasure. You know, we can go on and on and on. Are they all the same in this sense that you're talking about them?
For the most part, because they've been developed. You know, there's some quarter horses that have been bred to do just specific disciplines, you know, whether it be halter or reining or whatever. And these horses have been taught to gait in the show ring and been bred, those same horses, and they were looking for those characteristics to take and perform that gait in the show ring. And in order for a horse to do that, he has to be willing to put up with a lot of pressure mm-hmm. and a lot of stress. Mm-hmm. You take that horse out of that environment where he's not performing and you put him on a trail ride, he's not going to want to know what to do with himself because yeah. he's wanting to go, and you're just wanting to kind of slow down and relax. So most of the gaited horses have been bred to perform that gait at a very accentuated, whole lot of power and whole lot of thrust to look as animated as they can.
Yeah. Let me say, I lost my train of thought when they screamed there. Where was I going with that? Oh, well, I lost it. I'm sure I'll think of it later. So what is your breed of choice? Do you have a particular breed that you like to ride?
I don't pick breeds. I pick horses.
Okay.
I like the gaited horses because of their gait. You know, my back don't hurt when I get where I'm going. I tend to like a more stockier type horse. Some of the old foundation bred walking horses are really nice. We have a breed called the spotted saddle horse. Mm-hmm. There's several different. There's the national spotted saddle horse, and
that's very closely related to the Tennessee Walker, isn't it?
Yes, sir. They actually started about 15 minutes from my house. They bred a pony to a walking horse, and it was a spotted pony, and it was a very hardy mountain horse. We have a lot of hills in Tennessee, and they wanted a horse that was a little bit smaller and a little bit hardier. And maybe we didn't have a lot of the feed issues and a lot of the colic issues and that sort of thing. So they come up with this breed. And they're really naturally gaited. They gait really well, and they're hardy. You don't have a whole lot of problems with them. And they keep easier because they have a lot of pony in them. Feeding them is not a hard thing to do. They keep weight easy. They take the endurance of the ride better, whereas a lot of these high-strung horses tend to lose a lot of weight on trail rides. The spotted saddle horse doesn't. It's real hardy.
When we return, just how should your body move when you're riding a horse? Moses Woodson will give us some insights on that when the Horse Show Live continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hi, this is Pat Pirelli, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Thank you, Pat. Just saw Pat and Linda Pirelli. Just did a live TV show with them in Nashville just last week. That was absolutely a blast. Two of my favorite people. I always learn something from them every time I see them, and I wish them the very, very best. My guest is Moses Woodson, a trainer of gaited horses from Tennessee, and I know he has some ideas that are very compatible with Pirelli Natural Horsemanship. But first, you know, you're talking earlier about balance, and I thought of what I was going to ask you about that. It sounds to me like if the horse has a tendency to want to just go, 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 maybe you're teaching him a little bit of mental balance, as you pointed out, to where he could find a happy medium where he could go a little bit more slowly. I guess one of the traditional common wisdoms about gaited horses is it's difficult to go on a trail ride with gaited horses unless you're also riding a gaited horse.
Yeah.
Can you get them to slow themselves down and you know, go at a pace that a quarter horse could keep up with?
Yes, it's real simple to do, but nobody does it because it does take work. It's not rocket science to do. You have to do things that slow the horse's mind down.
Let's jump into that. How would you do that? This is valuable, by the way. I bet there's a lot of people listening that would say, I would like to have my horse gait, but at a slower gait.
If you have a horse, number one, that does tend to get out of control and wants to go, 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 on the ground first, you need to have a whole lot of influence over that animal. And I always ask people, you know, what makes a wild horse go to water? What makes a wild horse herd go to fresh graze? It's the influence that the leader has over the horse. And we're real mechanical. We live in a mechanical world. You know, we turn this knob, we get this. You know, we pull this lever, we get that. With the horse, it's about influence. It's about what the leader's doing to cause that horse to do something else. So instead of pulling on your horse to get it to stop, let's start when we're working our horses forward, giving them the opportunity to notice that we quit going with them.
Okay.
See, instead of just pulling that horse out of there, that puts it up to the horse. If you want to stop your feet, you got to pay attention to me. And then we can say, okay, if I can get this horse to stop when I stop, not by pulling on him, but I just quit, then when I take and I want to go faster, the horse goes faster. When I go slower, the horse goes slower because he's looking to me for change. And that's the way that the horse works naturally in the wild. You know, the stud wants them to go, they go. You know, the lead mare wants them, they go. When they stop, they stop. And it's nobody has a rope on them. Nobody's out there dragging them around. So that's the first line of communication you have with that horse. And
all this from the ground.
All of it's from the ground to start with. We always start on the ground first because you have more leverage, you have more control on the ground than you do in the saddle. And then you transfer that to their back. Now, that's just one line of a program that we do to get our horses to slow down mentally. So we transfer it to the ground. We use our seat. And we teach seat position. A lot of people think about seat position as being an advanced maneuver. We teach our seat position day one. When I sit down, you can stop. When I come out of the saddle, you can go. And they pick it up really quick. And it's the same thing that's going on the ground. When I want you to go, we go. When I stop, we stop. And you transfer that over to the saddle. Mm-hmm. So when I'm riding, we're going. When I quit riding,
people can't
stop.
See you on the radio, but you're actually kind of moving in your seat. So you're kind of creating a motion that you want the horse to kind of get with.
correct?
Yes, sir.
And then if you wanted him to slow down or stop, you would just change that motion, quit riding. Yeah.
I see a lot of people, they're kind of like, for lack of a better word, they're lazy riders. They want to sit back on their hips and just enjoy the ride. And that's a misnomer about gaited horses. When I ride, I'm on the inside of my thigh, and we're going forward.
More of a classical riding
position. More of a classical riding style. You know, my legs are off of my horse. And that right there, if you teach a horse that from the get-go, that your hands are for form, whether it be vertical, left, or right, mm-hmm. your seat's for impulsion and stopping, and your feet tell the horse which way to go, then you have more control of that animal, and you have more ways to control that animal and more ways to put that horse in different forms. Whereas if you go back to the traditional, more, you know, pull left to go left, pull right to go right. So you've got to take and have that influence over that animal on the ground and in the saddle.
Do you like to ride a horse with contact? Or do you work towards being able to have him gait with a loose rein?
One of the things that we do in our groundwork is we balance the horse out, and we teach the horse one side at a time to carry more weight on the inside hind leg. And the form that we put him in, we want him bent, okay? And when he's bent and we're able to push his inside hind farther up and under him towards the center of his body, that's the position that conditions his body. And he's able to carry more weight on that inside hind. We do that one side at a time. And that conditions the horse's back. And those are the same muscles that horse is going to use when we ask him to go straight away and get collected. And back to your question about whether I like contact or not, we teach our horses to stay off of the bit, not to make contact with the bit.
Self-carriage.
Yes, sir. We put our hands in a particular place, and we expect the horse to stay off of it.
I see.
We teach that in reverse first. The horse backs up and gets off the bit, and then we teach it to him going forward. When he's off the bit, we reward by release.
So you kind of just set your hands. You're not pulling back. You're not giving to him. You're just setting it, and
yes.
It's up to him to find a comfortable place relative to that bit.
Yeah, and sometimes, you know, you have, especially a horse that hadn't been rode that way, you know, you got a problem horse that he's been pushing forever. You've got to kind of push and push and push with your seat to get him to go forward and then make contact with his face. And when he gives, you've got to give.
Yeah.
And the very first day, you know, you might get him to give once or twice, and then tomorrow you get two steps, the next day you get three steps, and eventually he'll take and move around the whole rail, the whole arena in that self-carriage and stay off the bit. But that also builds muscle and also builds carriage, and the horse also finds balance there.
Yeah.
So that when you pitch the reins away, he goes, hey, I can carry you. I can carry, my back's strong, I can carry. So then you can just kind of go down through there gating without having to hold the horse in the gate.
Yeah.
It's a balanced feel.
Well, good for you. I love the way you're thinking about this. There's so much of horsemanship that applies across the board as far as building a relationship with an animal. But this is where, when we get into gaited horses and non-gaited horses, the physical nature of their body, the way they move, all of that does start becoming an issue. And I think you've addressed that very, very nicely. My guest has been Moses Woodson. Moses, you've got a website.
Yes, sir.
Spit it out.
www.tnhorsetrainingclinics.com.
All right. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
Still to come, Dana Hokana joins us to talk about changing the Western pleasure performance discipline for the better. Is it possible? Is it already happening? This is The Horse Show Live. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. We'll be right back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Welcome back, everybody. This is The Horse Show live from Equine Affair, Massachusetts. I'm your host, Rick Lamb, and I'm delighted to welcome to our show Dana Hokana. Dana, welcome.
Thank you.
You know, all these years our paths have been crossing. We've never had a chance to kind of get to know one another. So what the heck? Let's do it on the radio.
All right. It's great.
I want to ask you to explain what it is that you do and kind of where you fit into the horse industry. Your name is so familiar with to me. When you first meet somebody, how do you explain what you do?
Well, I train horses, I raise horses, and I teach people to ride. And my goal is to show people that they can do it too. I started out without a lot of background in horses. I was an only child and grew up in an apartment daydreaming about horses. And I learned that I think I made it happen in my dreams before it even happened, because I'm pretty much living the life that I wanted to. I started working for horse trainers when I was in my teens, and I started showing and going that route. And I wanted excellence. I saw a lot of trainers give people a bill of goods that I felt like they wanted them dependent on them, the trainer. And I wanted to teach people techniques that they could do it themselves, and to give people hope you could do it too.
Yeah. Do you have a personal favorite discipline that you like to pursue yourself?
I personally love Western pleasure, because I love making a horse move the best he can be with a soft flowing beautiful motion. And I am a fanatic on that. I hate that artificial movement. I want my horses to have flow and cadence and forward motion. But I've learned that the principles that make an excellent Western pleasure horse, when you don't take the shortcuts, are the same principles that apply to horsemanship, Western riding, reining, understanding how a horse moves, their arc, their body, their flexion, their cadence, their rhythm in their gaits are the same things that my daughters, who are top reining riders, use in the reining arena, and that I use when I train my Western pleasure horse. I believe that we need to get away from the theory that there is only one event or one way, and the principles apply to everything you do with horses.
If somebody that wanted to ride dressage, they're going to use the same basic principles in doing Western pleasure.
I believe that Western pleasure done right is a lot of dressage techniques.
Now, it has to drive you crazy that Western pleasure kind of dipped to a
quite a low at one point. I mean, I think it's getting better now in terms of very artificial movement from horses. Yes. And some pretty questionable training techniques. How did you feel about that when all that was happening? Was it kind of a losing battle?
Oh, it was discouraging. And what was the most discouraging was I watched good people that wanted to come into our industry quickly leave and get discouraged with it, and rightfully so. Who wants to watch horses looking uncomfortable and some people would say half crippled going around the arena, and putting people on that really weren't hooked up with their horses and really didn't know how to ride, and into this elusive sport and elusive event called Western Pleasure. It deserved the criticism that it got. I didn't like it.
Yeah. It was very interesting because that seemed to be an area where people with a lot of money to throw at something would throw it at a horse and a trainer in order to put their young daughter or something on it for a 10-minute performance in a show ring, and then the daughter maybe had no other contact even with the horse, and it was a very bizarre thing. And the inflated value of some of those Western Pleasure horses had to do with, you know, how they did in the show ring. And I was very disappointed. That my exposure to it in kind of covering it for the media, I was happy to see that the industry started kind of cleaning itself up. And how would you characterize it today? Is it significantly better?
I believe it is getting better, and you are so right. That's exactly what people would do. You know, they really didn't need to ride. In fact, the trainers would keep the riders off of their horses, and they would intimidate the horses to such a point that it would work for that 5 or 10 minute ride. And the judges also were not really well trained or schooled in movement, and they would learn. That's where the politics centered, where they, you know, out of general frustration, they would pick ones they knew, or, you know, they would just pick who's well known. And I really believe it's getting away from that now. You need to learn, you need to be able to ride your horse, and you need to know your horse to compete at a high level. And AQHA, I believe, has done a really good job of trying to educate people and get away from the horses that are over-canted, shut down, forebeated, too much spur stop and leg control, unnatural training techniques that were used. And they're now defining that and giving judges identifiable little symbols and symptoms that the horses are doing that tell volumes of what's really going on.
You know, one of the things I thought was a positive development is when they started requiring the Western Pleasure horses to move out at a faster trot. So that little jog that got to be such a crippled looking thing wasn't the only trot type movement that they required. And I don't know what they call that. Is that an extended trot? Or?
Yes, they call it the extended trot. And they also, the year in 2000, I was reserve world champion on my stallion invested dimension. And that is the year they also asked us in the finals at the World Show to extend the lope. And I loved it because many of those horses had been so shut down in their movement. When they extended the lope, they could not perform a beautiful lope, and a true balanced good Western Pleasure horse ought to be able to lope fast, lope slow, trot fast, trot slow, yeah, and adjust their speeds accordingly. So,
well, good for you. Well, you're a positive force, obviously, in the show world. Are you confining your work mostly to people that have interest in showing?
Well, at home, my clients that I help and train, yes, but I do a lot of clinics all over the country, and I about 4 times a year have a clinic at my ranch, and a lot of different people come to ride with me. I have 2-day and 3-day clinics that I offer. I just did one where some ladies from Canada that only ride dressage came to ride with me, and they had a great time and were thrilled. So I love teaching people at all levels, and I think that's why I fit in at this equine affair and different clinic settings like this, because I just want to help people improve at whatever level they're at.
Do you find that the people that come to you, is there one problem or one misconception that seems to keep coming up over and over again that you wish you could just sort of, you know, wave a magic wand and impart magically some wisdom to people about that?
I honestly believe the thing that is the most common problem that I deal with is people have not been taught how to sit a horse. They've not been taught what part of their body to unlock on the horse, and they really aren't given a basic educational knowledge of the horse's movement and the components required to move correctly, like the jog is a 2-beat, the lope is a 3-beat, the walk is a 4-beat. And you need to understand principles of your horse no matter what event you do, and you also need to understand where to unlock your body. And I felt strongly that many trainers focus on a particular thing like heels down or your shoulder back or stiffen, when in fact that was actually the seminar I just gave. We started out by unlocking the body, learning to get in rhythm with the horse, learning to unlock their pelvis. We worked on deep breathing and proper breathing techniques. We worked on finding the rhythm and counting it and getting hooked up with the horse. Then all the little problems like the shoulders twisting and the heels needing to come down, it all fell into place. And I just think it needs to start with learning to feel your horse and unlock on your horse.
So that focus on heels down, head up, all that kind of stuff, those are kind of on symptoms rather than the underlying causes of the problem.
I really believe that.
Explain to me a little bit more about this idea of unlocking the body. What do you mean by that?
When I was a teenager, I had my horses on the beach in Newport and Corona Del Mar, and we would ride bareback.
I'm so sorry to hear that.
That was rough, I know.
Tough life for a kid.
Okay. I started out running a rent string in Laguna Canyon.
Oh,
and we would, and this was a short time. This was after my mother married and moved to the beach area when I was a teenager. But we would ride bareback, and we would feel the freedom, and we would ride up and down the beach and feel the movement of the horse. And if we didn't unlock our body with that horse riding bareback, we would fall off. And where I feel that carries over so much into the show arena is people actually resist their horse's motion and even get in the wrong spot on their back. And I feel it applies across the board, and that's why I feel like the techniques that I teach can help anyone at any level. My daughter, I taught her for years to ride bareback, sit on her horse, unlock her body, and she won the Congress 2 years in a row in the horsemanship. And even though my specialty might have been Western pleasure, the principles would apply. The first year she won it under all 4 judges' cards. The next year she won it under 3 of the 4. Now she rides reiners, and the people that she rides with talk about how she knows where to sit a horse and that she's a beautiful rider. But really there's specific principles that anybody can learn to do that, whether they ride English, Western, reining, trail, pleasure. And the pleasure horses, when you learn to sit on a horse's back in the correct spot, they are allowed the freedom of how to move. When you understand the mechanics of a 3-beat lope and the rhythm to that 1-2-3 beat, you can learn to sit accordingly to where your horse has that moment to lift up and roll up under you and move even better. So I just feel like it's valuable for all riders, and that's kind of where I've gone with it all.
So do you recommend that everybody learn to ride bareback?
Oh, I don't know if I want to say that. I would say that my history and the people that I teach that have learned that good old-fashioned way, they know the feel of a horse. And unfortunately, though, a lot of bareback riders, when they go into a saddle, not sure where to put their legs and their feet and legs in the stirrups, they then change their seats. So you don't have to learn to ride bareback first. But often that'll help me be able to put that picture in the rider's mind of that old visualization, that old feel of what it used to feel like. But no, you don't have to learn that way.
Do you have a website we could refer people to?
Yes, I do. It's www.hokana.com.
H-O-K-A-N-A.
Yes.
.com. What's the nationality of that? That's an unusual
Hokana.
Name.
My husband is Finnish. His family is Finnish. Scandinavian and Finnish.
I would have guessed Hawaiian or something.
A lot of people say that. A lot of people ask if it was on purpose that my name rhymes, but
Dana
that's
Hokana.
Just how it worked out.
All right. Well, my guest has been Dana Hokana. Thank you so much for being with us today on The Horse Show.
You're welcome, and thank you. It's been a pleasure.
So who stands the greatest chance of influencing horsemanship in the future? Well, of course, our young people. Coming up next, Jessica Lane and Katie Tennyson tell us about their experiences on the Easy Riders drill team from Missouri. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM Premium Horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD TV.
RFD TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from Equifest of Kansas in Wichita, Kansas. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show Live, and I have two lovely young ladies here, members of the Easy Riders Drill Team, Jessica Lane and Katie Tennyson. Ladies, welcome.
Hello.
Okay, for people who may not know what a drill team is, Jessica, let's start with you. What is a drill team?
It's kind of like a group of people that do patterns together and like certain moves at like horse shows like Equifest.
And they're all on different horses.
Yes. Okay.
How many, Katie, how many people are on your drill team?
We have 12 on the drill team right now.
Uh-huh. Are they all about the same age, or what's the age range?
Well, we actually range from 11 to 48.
48? That's quite a range.
Yeah.
So how do you, if I wanted to join your drill team, am I the right, do I have to be a woman or a female?
No.
Or do you have men
on
your
team? We have one boy on the team.
One boy.
Mm-hmm.
One very lucky guy.
Yes,
huh?
He is.
So what do you like best about it, Jessica?
Kind of just hanging out with my friends and getting to ride with my horse.
Yeah. What kind of horse do you have?
A half Hackney, half quarter horse.
Oh, okay. So a little on the shorter side?
Yeah.
Kind of
mm-hmm.
kind of like a big pony, small
yeah.
horse
yeah.
kind of a thing? What about you, Katie? Tell me about your horse.
I have an appendix paint mare, and her name's Sparky. She's been on the team for 3 years, and she's one of the calmest horses on the team. So.
Now, is that a good trait to have
yes.
for a drill horse, is to be calm?
Yes, very
sometimes
good.
You have to really get them going pretty good, don't you?
Yeah, she does whatever I ask her to.
Okay, so she'll turn it on when you ask her to.
Yep.
Okay. What is your favorite maneuver that you guys do? Jessica, let's start with you. What is the one you like the best out there when you're riding those horses, a particular maneuver, or the one that pleases the crowd, or the one that's the hardest?
The one one that I think pleases the crowd would probably be the weave. It's like a line, like two lines coming together, and then they weave in and out of each other. And then the hardest one would probably be the conjoined circles. It's like two groups of horses that are in circles, one on one side of the arena and then another circle on the other. And one person and from each side, they cross with each other. But it's hard because like you have to keep your spacing and you have to have the right pace and you have to like time everything really right.
That sounds really hard to me, because if you get your timing off, you guys are going to run into each other, aren't you?
Yeah.
Does that ever happen?
Yes, it has.
Does it ever happen in shows, in live shows, or is it mainly in practice when something goes wrong?
Mainly in practice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you're still kind of learning it and getting it all together.
Yeah.
Well, you talked about the pacing, and I suppose in some sports, they would call that rating your horse. In other words, controlling his speed so that he doesn't go, you know, faster isn't always better. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you need to have the speed just right so you're at a certain place at a certain time. How do you teach a horse to rate himself, especially when he's out there and all these other horses are running around? Katie, you want to tackle that?
Yeah.
It's a horse training question, I guess.
Yeah, you have to teach your horse to learn your light cues with your legs and your hands. If your horse misreads a cue, then they're going to go faster or slower. You want them to know exactly what you're asking them so that they can move the way you want them to, and they know that that's the way they need to go.
Are you using mostly your legs, or the amount of pressure on your legs to tell them to go faster or slower? Does it have something to do with the way you sit, the angle of your pelvis or whatever?
I use mostly my whole body for pace changes. I try to use less hands as possible, less leg as possible.
Do you ride with pretty much a loose rein and give them their full use of their head, or do you have contact when you ride?
I make them break at the pole. I always have to have the round body so that they're up and sitting, so that they're
the more collected posture, mm-hmm. more collected frame.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you, do you help some of the younger ones on the team with their riding?
Yeah.
Are you kind of like the resident horse expert?
Yeah, I'm one of the older riders, so when a new rider comes
in. I have no idea how old you are. I would never ask a lady how old she is, but I thought at first you were very young, but you seem like you're a little more mature than I thought, so I'm guessing you're late teens?
Yeah, 17.
17, okay.
Yeah.
See, I didn't ask you. You told me. I tricked you.
Yeah.
And to be fair, Jessica, how old are you?
I'm 13.
13. Okay. How long has this team been around, Jessica?
It's been around for 10 years.
And how long have you been on the team?
This is actually my first year.
Your first year?
Yeah.
So do you guys have special outfits? Unfortunately, I haven't had a chance to see you guys ride, so I'm kind of having to picture in my mind what you guys look like when you're performing. Do you have special uniforms that you wear?
We have a different outfit that we wear each drill, except for the flag drill that we do in the morning.
So you go out and you have wardrobe changes, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you like about it, Katie? I mean, you're a little bit older. How long have you been with this?
I've been on the team for 4 years.
So, obviously, you know, you're a teenager. You got a lot going on in your life. This sounds like it's a fair commitment of time.
Yes.
Why do you stick with it?
I stick with it because it's what I want to do. It helps me with my social skills, my leadership skills, which I have to have for later on in life. So.
Okay, explain to me the connection between riding your horse on a drill team and leadership skills.
Okay, when new riders come in, you have to teach them. So you have to have those leadership skills to teach the other younger riders how to do it. You have to have the proper, you have to be positive most of all the time.
Them.
Encouragement, yes.
Yeah.
Try not to be negative.
Do you ever have some that get kind of discouraged that it's a little too hard
yes,
or something?
All the time.
What do you say to pump them back up?
They will get better. All they have to do is work at it. That's what I tell them.
Yeah.
As long as they work at it. I mean, when I first joined the team, I cried every practice because
did you?
It was hard, but I got it together and I
okay,
got it working.
Okay, have you ever fallen off your horse while you were doing one of these drills?
No, I have never done that.
Does that ever happen? Do people ever fall off?
It's happened before. 2 years ago, a rider in front of me fell off her horse.
Well, hopefully she wasn't hurt.
No, she wasn't. She got right back on.
Okay. Well, I guess that's probably surprises people because this is, you know, sometimes you're moving out pretty well with these
yes,
horses, right?
Yeah.
And you're doing some complicated things. What level of skill do you require for somebody to be on the team? Do they have to show you that they can actually do this?
Yes, we have different levels that everybody has to pass. We have 6 levels that everyone has to pass to ride on the team.
Yeah.
It contains leg yielding, pivoting, side passing, lead changes, collectiveness, all of that.
Yeah.
So.
Jessica, are there specific positions on the team that are assigned to people, like on, say, a baseball team or something, where you have a, you have to be at a certain place at a certain time, certain roles you play? Or is everybody the same?
Not really. I mean, like, we kind of figure things out when we're doing practice, like who leads them in and who's like in the middle, who calls things and stuff like that.
But that's going to stay the same each time you do that particular maneuver?
Yeah, yeah.
That one person's the leader on that one, they're always the leader?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On that drill, sometimes it changes every other drill, though.
Okay.
You got to know where you're going. Like, if you're in one spot on the drill, the next drill you might be in a different spot. You always have to know where you're going to go and what the next move is.
Fascinating. Well, I'm always happy to see young people doing fun things with their horses.
Yeah.
Is this something you'd recommend for other folks?
Oh yeah, it's a blast.
Has it improved your riding?
Oh yes. Oh my gosh. When I joined the team, I was a trail rider. I didn't know anything, and I had a green horse. So, anybody can join the team, and they can become a great rider.
Has it helped your horse too?
Oh yeah.
I always think that having a job to do or something with purpose, regardless of what it is, mm-hmm. improves the rider and the horse.
Yes.
It sounds to me like you've got a great purpose there.
Yes.
All
definitely.
Right. Ladies, thank you so much. My guests have been Jessica Lane and Katie Tennyson of the Easy Riders. And that happens to be their website, theeasyriders.com. And it's all spelled out, TheEasyRiders. Ladies, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, I can always tell when I've had a particularly good show if I really would like to go back and spend more time with these guests, and such is certainly the case today. Thanks to Moses Woodson for being with us. His website, www.tnhorsetrainingclinics.com. Thanks to Dana Hokana, her website, www.hokana.com, H-O-K-A-N-A.com. And to our two young ladies, Jessica Lane and Katie Tennyson of the Easy Riders Drill Team, that website is www.TheEasyRiders.com. You know, when I saw that website, I thought, there's some motorcycle club somewhere just kicking themselves that they didn't get that that name. I bet they got that a long time ago, those great names. I can remember vividly in the late 90s when the internet kind of came on everybody's radar. I had a client at my recording studio at the time who was a bit of an entrepreneur, a risk taker, and he thought there might be some value in reserving a whole bunch of generic web domain names and then holding on to them, selling them later to the highest bidder. Now, I don't know whether that worked out for him, but I remember a story in the paper of a college-age student who did the same thing with the domain drugs.com. He auctioned it off and made hundreds of thousands of dollars. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.